Welcome to the Brown Carpet Podcast, where each episode we take a weird real news story and together we twist it into an even weirder film.
We do it live and we stream it on Facebook so the people at home can join in and make suggestions for the film's title, tagline, casting, soundtrack and story.
And at the end, we make a movie poster for the B-grade masterpiece, We Cook Up.
You can see all the movie posters we've made in the brown lit section of our website,
www.thebrowncarpetpod.com.
We also got a sweet ass merch page on there, so you can pick up a t-shirt, phone case, or throw pillow emblazoned with the BCP logo.
You can find us on iTunes, Stitcher, or Spotify, and if you're listening to this, you could be watching all the episodes on our YouTube channel.
Just search for the Brown Carpet Podcast, and you can see Corey's pretty little beady face.
Aww. If you've got a suggestion of a weird, funny headline you'd like us to turn into champagne cinema, hit us up on Twitter, Instagram, or email us at thebrowncarpetpod@gmail.com.
And now, let's get to the show.
Yeah.
I have come here to chew bubblegum and kick ass.
I jumped over three linebackers in midair, sprouted antlers like a gazelle.
No one laughs at a master quack fool.
Real nice.
Many have died from starvation due to the difficulty of finding enough food, such as seal.
Shut up. No more Mr. Nice Duck. That's it. Right, Mr. Sitz?
What do you make of that? You know, it's the most fantastic story I've ever heard.
The Brown Carpet Podcast.
Welcome to episode 40 of the Brown Carpet Podcast. That's right, 40. 40 episodes of this absolute tripe. Nonsense. Rubbish. Despite our best efforts, we try really hard. We fall short often. But guess what? We're still doing it. We're not going anywhere. I'm going to pipe in. I'm going to call Josh over the internet. He's in Jersey City right now, waiting for my call. Let me dial in. I'm calling Josh. It's ringing.
Corey.
Ah, Josh.
Yes,
there
Corey,
you are.
Can you hear me?
Hey, bud. How you doing?
Good, man. How you going?
I'm very well. How are you doing?
What's happening in Australia?
It's raining.
Oh, really?
It's raining. It stopped raining, but it's pretty miserable weather. How's it doing over there in Jersey City? I heard sirens.
Dude, it's cold as balls.
I heard sirens. Are you safe? Are you in a safe house right now?
Mate, I'm deep in the hood. I'm in a panic room right now. So if anything goes wrong, I'm on lockdown. It's all cool.
Yeah, wow. Well, I'm on the casting couch.
Yeah, this looks like the start of every porn video that I've ever clicked on.
That's what's going to happen today. The 40th episode is the episode that we finally fuck.
Hi, my name's Peyton. I'm interested in books and I like stamp collecting. Cool, Peyton. Do you want to just stand up and take your underpants off?
You know what you're here for, Peyton. You know what we know what we're paying you $25 for.
Mate, look, I hate to be a bummer, but I've got to start the show with a bit of bad news. I know last week we both kind of talked up our special guest we were going to have on the show.
Don't tell me that something's gone wrong with this, because I was hoping so hard that you had him.
Yeah, so in case you missed last episode, our beloved entrepreneur and Fire Festival organizer Billy McFarland was going to be coming on the show. Unfortunately, look, he sent me an email. I've got a statement from him. It says, due to circumstances out of my control, transportation to attend the Brown Carpet recording was not in place on time. At this time, we're working tirelessly to reschedule a guest hosting opportunity. This guest opportunity.
Hang on, sorry. Was that tirelessly or firelessly?
The guest episode is being postponed until we can further assess whether we can create a high quality experience that we envision. So, unfortunately, we're not going to have Billy on this episode, and it looks like I'm going to have to pay for those courtside Nick seats myself.
Yeah, wow.
Because he had a problem with his Visa card, so I guess I'll just sort it out for now.
But yeah, wow.
Very disappointed.
Well, you know what? You know, that's what happens. But I did hear. In other news, I did hear Ja Rule's trying to do a 2.0. He's trying to run another festival.
So, oh, awesome.
Yeah, so we'll see how that goes.
Oh, I have to snatch up a few ticks as soon as they come out.
Yeah.
Speaking of big events, this weekend is the 91st Academy Awards.
The Night of Nights. None of our films were up for any of the nominations, which I was a bit disappointed in, Josh, to be honest.
Snubbed once more, mate. I'm pretty stinky about the whole thing. But hey, there's always next year. We've got a lot of stuff in the pipes.
There's always next year.
But I was figuring, rather than doing our top three we usually do, why don't we do our Oscars predictions?
Okay, I've got my list here.
I've also got our beloved producer has also sent in his predictions. So I guess we can just run through them and see.
Yeah, let's do
one
it.
Of us. Who've you got for best picture?
I went with what a lot of this is what I like, maybe not what's going to win.
For predictions, that's probably the worst way to do it because you have terrible taste. But sure, let's hear it.
Okay, well, I had Black Klansman.
That was my favourite film of the year, but I did not pick it because I don't think it's going to win Best Picture. I have The Favourite.
I have not seen that. Good film?
It is a great film, actually. It's really good. Great script writing, amazing cinematography. It's a period piece, basically about these two assistants to a queen jostling for position.
What has Damien got for that one?
Damo has tipped Roma.
Has Damien just selected Roma for every category?
Yes, yeah. He has. He's an art house man, Damo, and he likes his black and white foreign language pieces. So what do you got for best performance by an actor in a leading role?
So I've gotten Rami Malek from Bohemian Rhapsody.
How good was he?
He was great, but I know yours is awesome. Yours is probably going to win.
I've gone with Christian Bale from Vice.
Just body transformation. They're going to give it to him for just converting his body. It can't be good. I just feel like the fluctuations can't be good for your body.
Oh, yeah. He's going to fall apart for sure. But let's enjoy it while he's doing it, mate. Damo tipped Bradley Cooper.
Oh, so mainstream, Damien.
Star is Born. He's so mainstream.
I know.
What do you got for actress in a leading role?
They're going to give it to Lady Gaga. And from all accounts, I haven't seen the film, but I heard she was pretty great.
That's my pick, actually. I've gone Lady Gaga. I thought she was awesome. Damo's picked Glenn Close. I don't even know what film she's in. Is that Green
Book? The Wife. Next up, we've got Best Performance by an Actor in a Supporting Role.
Who you got?
Mahershala Ali, is it? Mahershala.
Sorry, can you say that again? What was that?
Mahershala Ali.
I'm sorry? I'm not sure. It might be the connection.
Mahershala Ali.
Are you having a stroke right now? What are you?
I haven't seen The Green Book, but he's one of my favourite actors, so...
So you haven't seen half the films that you're tipping, is what you're saying?
No, I haven't seen it. I have not seen a film in the list, if I'm honest. I have not seen...
You saw Black Klansman.
Oh, I've seen Black Klansman. That's the one I voted for Best Picture, because it's the only one I've seen.
It's the only one I've seen. Oh, look. Well, speaking of Black Klansman, that's my pick for supporting role. I've got Adam Driver.
Oh, okay. And I think Damo's got that as well, right?
Yes.
But I should say, I have seen Roma pop up on Netflix, and I've seen the trailer play.
Oh, okay.
So, and it looks beautiful.
Are you giving us a tease of your cinematography choice there? Or?
Yeah, definitely. Best performance by an actress in a supporting role.
I am going to go Emma Stone for her work in The Favourite.
How good was she in The Favourite? She was amazing, right?
I think we've already established, mate, you have no idea how good she was in The Favourite.
Who's Damien Gorm? Marina de Tavira? Roma. See, he's just gone hard on Roma the whole way through.
I think she was a non-actor before she did it, which is pretty amazing.
Oh, okay. Well, she's just an ordinary person, then I don't support it. I only support celebrities. Best achievement in directing, Josh. Who have you got?
Mate, this is a no-brainer for me. Spike Lee, top of his game this year.
Oh, it was a great film. Yeah, yeah. And I loved Baby Denzel.
Have you seen interviews with him? That guy is freakily like his dad, the way he laughs.
He sounds, he talks, he walks. He is Denzel Washington.
And Damo has unsurprisingly gone with Roma again, Alfonso Cuarón. So who you got for best original screenplay?
I went Green Book.
You're so full of shit. No, tell us, what was it about the trailer to Green Book?
Well, the trailer for Green Book on the YouTubes was really cool. It had lots of actors that win awards in it. Can I just say, a great screenplay, really well written.
Sumptuous use of prose. I've gone with Paul Schrader's First Reformed, which I've also not seen.
Oh,
but
great.
Paul Schrader wrote Taxi Driver, so I figure, how bad can he be?
And no surprise, Damien has selected Roma again.
Roma, yeah.
For best adapted screenplay, Josh, it looks like it's a three-way Black Klansman.
Okay, that sounds like another porn film I was just watching.
One thing that bothers me about the whole A Star is Born thing, it's been done.
Three times. This is the fourth one.
Here we are with a podcast where we come up with original screenplay ideas every episode. We can't get a look in because they're just redoing The Star is Born.
It's a slap in the face is what it is.
It really is.
All right, mate, who you got for...
Cinematography.
I watched a short YouTube clip today that changed my mind. I was down for The Favourite, but I'm thinking it's probably going to be Roma now because of that long one shot at the end.
I wonder what Damo's got. Oh, yep, Roma.
Oh, it's Roma. Amazing.
it's got it for sure, that one. Every frame is a painting, as they say.
You're full of shit.
I know.
Film editing, we've all picked the same thing here as well. Did you see Bohemian Rhapsody?
I have. Actually, that's another one I've seen. I saw it at the cinema.
There you go.
I saw it at the cinema. Okay. So I've seen two.
Amazing.
The way they nailed that Live Aid concert at the end.
Oh, the Wembley scene. Isn't that amazing?
It's, and when you see it side by side, the actual footage. Wow.
Yeah. I really want to talk to you about production design because I think you're just... Do you want to talk us through the thinking behind your prediction on this one?
Okay, well, I thought production design, I thought it always goes to stuff that's elaborate and musical, I mean, or costumey. Costumey?
Costumey.
That's what I did. I got them confused, I think. I think I used the costume design logic. Oh, God. But I've gone for the same one for both production design and costume design. Mary Poppins. Great.
What was it about the production design of Mary Poppins that infused your heart with...
I think it captured the fairy tale essence magically. I don't think I've seen any other film do it like it did it. It was so whimsical.
Like a summer dress fluttering in the breeze.
Yes.
Well, I thought it looked pretty shit. I haven't seen it, but I went with The Favourite on that one.
Where'd you go? The Favourite.
The Favourite.
Oh, I thought you said I went with The Favourite as in the betting.
As did Damo.
Okay.
Both me and Damo and The Favourite, that one. Best achievement in costume design. So back on the Mary Poppins train, mate.
Yeah, always.
I've gone The Favourite again, and Damo has gone Black Panther.
Interesting choice.
Wakanda.
Best achievement in music written for a motion picture.
Yeah, Black Klansman. This is one that you actually have seen.
Yeah. I thought it was great.
Damo is on the Mary Poppins train on that one.
Damien. I think Damien had his eyes closed when he filled out this Excel doc.
He's just throwing darts to the board.
Best achievement in music written for motion. I think this will win purely because of the success the music has had outside of this film.
That song, Shallow, by Lady Gaga, that's an absolute banger.
It is going to win.
100%. So why did you not pick it?
Because I like Kendrick Lamar. I do like the Black Panther soundtrack, although I haven't seen the film. And that's where I went.
Hey, look, if you want to lose this predictions thing, that's on you, mate. Where did you go for best achievement in sound mixing?
Okay. I went with Bohemian Rhapsody.
Okay, I can see that. The sound seemed well mixed to me.
What have you got here, Josh?
First Man.
Oh, I downloaded that. Didn't watch it.
Oh, nice.
So I'm admitting to piracy on camera. And what's Damien going on that one?
Is Roma in the thing? Oh, look, he went away from Roma. He went Bohemian Rhapsody as well.
Yeah, I mean, Roma's got the pictures sewn up, but it's nowhere near on the sound, in the sound categories.
Best achievement in sound editing.
And Josh, this is a film, we've all gone the film that you've chosen. I haven't seen it, no surprise, but can you, hey, you're laughing, but I listened to a podcast called The Cutting Room, and the host is an editor, and he talks to other editors, and they talked about the sound editing of The Quiet Place.
This was, apart from Black Klansman, this was my favourite film of the year. This was an absolute exercise in tension and use of sound like I'd never experienced before. Like, being in the cinema for this film was a really amazing experience. Like, people in the cinema were eating their crisps quietly so as not to make noise and stuff, like biting them really. It's an amazing film.
Yeah.
I highly recommend.
I believe you. Josh, let's get cracking into this episode. It's a doozy.
It's freaky, man. Here's the headline. A mysterious 15th foot washes up in Canada. So where are they coming from?
Weird.
Let me read you the story. Mystery surrounds a man's foot inside a running shoe which has washed up in Canada. The British Columbia Coroner's Service is seeking help to identify the foot which washed up in West Vancouver in September. It is the 15th case involving a human foot washing up in southwest British Columbia since 2007.
What the hell?
Coroners, I know, how weird is that? Why are they faked? The foot belonged to a man under the age of 50. However, a DNA test did not match any missing persons cases. 10 of the 15 feet have been matched to missing persons, while 5 remain unidentified. The shoe was manufactured between February 1st and April 17th, 2017, and the department described it as in relatively new condition.
What, the shoe or the foot?
The shoe.
I doubt the
foot would be in good condition. The most recent find before September's foot was in May last year when another man's foot washed up inside a running shoe, CBC reported. Most of the 15 feet were determined to be men's, except for 2, which were confirmed to be women's. A number of theories have been raised over the years concerning the feet. In 2008, Royal Canadian Mounted Police told the Toronto Star it believed some of the feet were from men who died in a plane crash on Quandra Island in 2005. 5 men were on board, but only 1 body was located. However, this wouldn't explain the extra feet, since 4 or 5 missing bodies at most would mean 8 to 10 feet.
Oh, this is mysterious. I like this.
Some experts believe the most likely explanation is the feet belong to people who have taken their own lives.
But why? Yeah, but they don't take their, cut their, oh, they're just the body decomposes in the foot. But why are only feet showing up? That's the weird thing for me.
They've only found one pair. The rest have all just been single feet.
Yeah, right. This is a good one, Josh. So whose story is this, Josh?
Is it the police investigating? Is it the man missing a foot? Is it the foot cutter? Is it a kid who finds the foot? What do you I mean, is this a long awaited sequel to Footloose?
Is it a serial killer that's his signature, the foot?
And is he keeping one foot and getting rid of the other?
Yes.
Is he not like...
He's Daniel Day-Lewis and he only keeps the left foot.
I've been thinking about it all week, mate, and I've got an idea. As a kickoff point.
Start painting.
Black and white screen, just like Roma. Title comes up, 1945. We open on a British B-24 bomber flying high above the Pacific Ocean. Two pilots are returning from a successful bombing run.
Yep.
In one seat, Colin Walker is staring at a small black and white photograph of his girl when suddenly the plane pitches forward. Everything okay, Derek? Sorry, old chap. I've just got a blasted itchy foot. We watch as Derek reaches down in the cramped cockpit to scratch at his foot, causing his chest to bump the control wheel and rock the small plane forward. Steady on, Derek. We'll be home soon enough. Socks off. You can give that nuisance foot a jolly good seeing to. Derek squirms uncomfortably. The itch is bad. He's sweating. He can't take it. He goes for it again. Stretching forward, he manages to catch the edge of his helmet just underneath the metal rim of the control panel, locking himself up against the wheel, causing the plane to nosedive. We watch as the small plane hurtles down through the clouds towards the ocean. Inside the cockpit is chaos. Alarms are sounding and instruments are going crazy as Colin tries to pull Derek free from his awkward position. And when he finally does, he pulls up on the yoke in an attempt to level the plane out. The shuddering plane struggles against gravity, straining to regain control. Through the swirling clouds, there suddenly appears a mountain. It's too late, and the plane crashes headlong into a dense section of tropical jungle. A coil of black smoke twists into the sky.
Right.
You with me so far?
Yes. I'm sensing tribe vibes.
I got a second part. We open up, it's colour this time. Beautiful ocean, 1985. A sailing boat lowers its sheet and tosses the anchor overboard. A small dinghy drops into the water. Five people row the boat ashore. On the beach, they begin to prep for a mission ahead. It's a religious expedition to explore and bring the word of Jesus to this remote island. It is rumored that there's a tribe existing here who have remained completely uncontacted and untouched by civilized society. The Christian team is led by a husband and wife team and three young missionaries. They finalize the contents of their backpacks and the father leads them in a group prayer where he outlines the goals of the mission. So the Christian soldiers set off into the jungle, optimistic, enthusiastic, and full of song. The jungle is dense and filled with the exotic and deadly wildlife. At lunchtime, they break to eat and pray. One of the brothers takes the opportunity to climb up a majestic tree, which brings him out above the canopy of trees and provides him a view of the majestic valley around them. Through his binoculars, he spots in the distance what appears to be a huge stone statue of a foot. But before he can double check what he's looking at, a monkey steals his binoculars. Confused but unsure, he returns to the group and attempts to explain what he's seen. The father gets freaked out, his eyes get wide. Then it's true. They're really still out here. Who's out here, Father Pete? The Footsi people. The sky darkens and the thunder rumbles. As rain begins, tribal drums can be heard in the distance.
That's a great setup. That's a big opening two scenes.
So I mean, I don't know where we go from there, but I'm thinking, you know, obviously we're connecting the two.
Well, I think the Footsi people, that crash led to the severing of the pilot's foot and it showered from the sky.
Oh, okay.
And it was they saw that as an offering from their god.
His foot fell from the sky, is that what you're saying?
Yeah, I'm saying like the plane blew up, his foot flew down and onto this same island. And
right.
that was the beginning of their worship of the foot. The foot was an offering, as they saw it, from their gods.
Right.
So the thing is, though, people are trying to contact these guys, and every time they do, they kill them and sacrifice their feet to their foot god.
Right. Okay.
So these little missionaries you've just set up are in for a bit of a shock. Trouble is afoot, if you will.
So anytime a white person shows up, the only thing of value that they have is the feet.
Yeah, exactly.
And they need to be removed and... I don't know, are they keeping the feet? Are they...
Well, what they do is, as is custom of the Footsi people, they cut off both feet.
Right.
They offer one to their altar, to their god, and then they set the other foot to the ocean.
Afloat.
Sure.
Are they aware of this tribe? Like, are the Christians aware that this tribe is foot hungry?
Yeah.
Do they discover it along the way?
They discover it quite shockingly when one of them gets their feet cut off.
Okay, so maybe that first night, after he spotted them, they make a camp, it's raining,
yep.
They're all freaking out.
Yep.
That night, one of them loses their feet. I reckon it should be the most experienced, like maybe the leader of the group is the one that loses his feet because, like, I don't know, you cut the head off the snake.
Exactly.
And they're fucked. So,
exactly.
So maybe the main father
yep.
loses both his feet. So now it's just like the wife and these three young missionaries have to struggle on without him.
And I like the idea that they used sort of bush island tropical medicine to like sedate them so he was able to stay asleep and they were able to remove the feet.
Right.
I also just thought of a tagline.
Oh yeah?
Surviving this is going to be no mean feat.
That's pretty good.
It's not that great.
That's not bad at all.
Anyway, so obviously the leader has lost his feet.
They got him on a bush stretcher.
Actually, are we going to start casting this? Are we going to cast the flashback in the plains?
I was thinking a couple of young British actors for that.
Oh, yep. So Tom Hiddleston, is it?
Sure. Yeah.
Tom Hiddleston. And who else?
Maybe Daniel Radcliffe.
Daniel Radcliffe's perfect.
And I reckon it could be Daniel Radcliffe's foot that they worship.
Okay. Yeah, I'm sure there's some people out there that worship Daniel Radcliffe's feet.
Oh, yeah.
It's a big what?
I've got a few folders on my hard drive, mate, that you'd be very interested in. Who do you reckon for the Christians? So we've got the father and wife team, and then we've got three younger missionaries.
Okay, well...
Your mate Pete Holmes would work well for this.
Pete Holmes is such a ray of sunshine, and like if there was ever going to be like a Christian, like a role for like a funny Christian, it'd be him, right? Okay, so him and maybe Kirsten Schaal.
Yeah, perfect.
There's more of them, right?
The three younger missionaries.
So who else do you think?
Well, I was thinking we set up that rule last week. We're always going to cast an Australian. So why don't we get Margot Robbie in there?
Oh, let's put Margot Robbie in everything. Come on.
Okay, why not?
Dimitri Martin?
Yes.
He could be a good be a Christian boy.
Do you know who Bo Burnham is?
Yeah, I love Bo Burnham. All right, cool. So I like to think that they're shipwrecked, or does their ship just, they come back to their ship after the first incident and the ship's gone.
Oh, yeah.
The boat's gone. No, it's burnt. It's ashes. So we've got Pete Holmes' characters all stumped up.
Yeah, we got Christian, Margot, Bo and Dimitri left.
Yeah.
And you know, none of these guys are leadership material.
Maybe Margot Robbie... Now you mentioned the stump mm-hmm. thing. Maybe she has a secret fetish for stumps and she's... Do we want to put that in the film?
Like the other one's like, we need to go to the jungle and get some food. She goes, that's right, I'll just stay with Father Pete. I'll just take care of his wounds.
And we have one of the weirdest sex fetish scenes on mainstream cinema ever, where she humps...
Are you talking about full-on stump penetration?
No, Josh, come on. I'm not.
You just said humps his stump, dude.
Yeah, but like it's like a romantic, beautiful scene.
Well, she's just like grinding on his stump.
Think Blue Lagoon, but a stump.
But with a bloody stump. Yeah, that's beautiful, man. Yeah. That's a really lovely scene.
And I just like to picture that he's not into it at all. He's in a lot of pain.
Yeah, but he can't get away. She's just gonna grind on him until she's done. Actually, like he falls asleep. Finally, he just passes out through all the pain and the blood loss or whatever.
Yeah,
and she just starts quietly grinding away on it, and he wakes up mid-hump. He's like, what are you doing? And she just covers his mouth. She's like, shh, just let it happen. Just let it happen.
Yeah.
Okay, so while she's humping his feet and the other guys are out in the jungle, is maybe she the next one to go?
Yep, she's gone next.
The footsies descend on her?
But I think it becomes increasingly more violent, Josh. I think it's just it's about the murder, and then the feet become... Obviously, they take the feet are the trophies, but they're going to die in a pretty vicious manner.
They basically dismantle her on the beach and leave all the parts except for the feet. The feet are gone again. So now it's just Bo Burnham, Kirsten Schaal, and Dimitri Martin left. Night has fallen. They've got food, but the horror is really ratcheting up at this point. Well, maybe Dimitri could rip out his guitar and play them a little bit of Crowded House, maybe a rendition of Fall at Your Feet, calm them down.
I see what you did. I like the idea of one of them goes crazy. Maybe Dimitri Martin, he gets a poison dart or something, or like through the thing, and then pulls it out.
Oh, yeah.
Pulls it out and doesn't think too much of it, but it sends him, the toxins send him crazy, And he has this, he has his own bloodlust.
So he's having like hallucinogenic flashes of evil and demons and stuff.
Yeah, and he cuts his own feet off.
Oh, right. He makes an offering.
Yeah.
He cuts ahead of the game.
He cuts his own feet off and bleeds out. Gone.
Dimitri's gone. Okay, so Pete Holmes, but you know, he's lost a lot of blood. He's not in a good way.
A lot of blood.
How are these guys going to try and get off the island? What's the, what have they got left?
Well, I think they're gradually trying to get off the island, but it's so dense, the bush. And I think they think they're going the right way. It's that classic thing of like, oh, we're close. And then they stumble head straight into the middle of the township, the village.
I've got an idea.
Okay.
I've got an idea. The two of them have to carry Pete Holmes, right? Bush stretcher.
Yep.
The two of them are carrying him. Obviously, they're going to try and go away from the tribe as far as possible. So maybe we have this long sequence where they're kind of being hunted on their way through. They're kind of like Apocalyptico type thing where they can hear them coming. It's like a long, elongated chase sequence. They're carrying this guy through the jungle. He's dying. They finally, maybe they have to jump off a cliff or something quite dramatic. They think they've gotten away. They think they've gotten a little... When suddenly a net drops from the sky, they're scooped up into this thing, thinking they've been captured by the tribe. They're like, oh, we're fucked now. But instead of the tribe, stay with me, Daniel Radcliffe staggers out of the bush. No feet.
Yes.
He's been living on the other side of the island the whole time.
Oh, this is great.
Scared of the tribe. He doesn't know that the tribe doesn't know he's there, but he's been kind of like living in secret. He's now this old man. He's all fat and crazy and shit.
Yeah, this is
but
great.
But he's there like hobbled. Like maybe he's managed to survive off bush foods for like the last 50, 60 years or whatever.
This is amazing.
You know those dudes they find in the middle of the jungle who still think the war is going? Like these Japanese soldiers that they find?
Yeah.
He still thinks the war's taking place. So he's been trying to rebuild the radio for like 40 years and he's just got it to the point where he can make contact, but he doesn't want the Japs to know, like he's full on paranoid and stuff.
Yeah.
About the whole thing.
Maybe we should have casted someone who's Japanese in this film. So there could have been some...
Oh, that's good.
There could have been some tension there, so...
Daniel Day Kim.
Okay. Sorry, we'll switch the characters around. So at first he tries to like, he helps them and then realizes he's Japanese and they have a tussle.
And they have to convince him that the war's over.
Yeah.
He's no longer the enemy.
Let's say Radcliffe character gets them all on a boat that he's been building this whole time.
Oh yeah. Okay.
And he sacrifices himself and pushes the boat off. And then they just all swarm on him.
But we see like he's redeemed himself because he's actually done this good thing for a Japanese kid. He's come to terms with his inbred racism and he like gives him a high five and like single tear down the cheek as the boat pushes off and the tribe closes over him.
I've got an idea. They push off, it's like night on dusk, it's night time. And they just all they collapse into the boat. They wake up in the morning and they're beached on another island. And they get up and they're like, ah, oh, looking around, trying to make what's going on. And the island they beach on is that Sentinelese island where they kill the missionaries. And they just get killed.
They wake up in the morning, it's like, it looks like paradise all around them.
Yeah.
And the next thing that happens is a spear just comes straight through one of their necks.
Yeah.
And the other one just gets like two arrows in the head.
Yeah. That's the end.
Okay, so we need a title for this, mate. What have we got title-wise?
Apocatiptoe.
Sure. How about My Left Feet? Why don't we go with the name of the tribe, Playing Footsie.
Perfect. Playing Footsie for the title. Surviving this is going to be no mean feat.
Solid.
Can you do a recap in one paragraph?
Oh, I will do my best. Flashback to 1945, a pilot with an itchy foot crashes his plane into a remote island in the middle of the Pacific Ocean. Jump forward 60 years, a group of Christian missionaries arrive at the island there to spread the word of God, but instead of finding a peaceful tribe, they find...
The Footsies?
Who kill them off one by one in more and more brutal ways. One of them goes crazy when he gets a poisoned dart in the neck. They get chased by this tribe across the island. They leap down a waterfall where they are captured by the original pilot who survived in secret on the other side of the island.
Yep.
Who still thinks that the war is taking place. He's all paranoid and freaked out that the Japanese are going to get him. He's been building a boat the whole time. They have a massive struggle because one of the Christians is Japanese, but they're able to convince him that the war is over and there's nothing to fear. And so in the ultimate act of sacrifice, right as the tribe closes in, he pushes the boat out into the ocean and he's swarmed over by the tribe and murdered. And then in the final scene of the film, we see the boat has washed up on a different island, and it seems like paradise. Just before we close on a happy ending, they're hit by spears and arrows from a completely different tribe who have never been touched by humans and hate Christian missionaries.
Perfect.
Playing footsie, surviving this is no mean feat.
All right, that's another episode done. Until next time, don't forget to flush.
See you, cunts.
I have come here to chew bubblegum and kick ass.
He jumped over three linebackers in midair, sprouted antlers like a gazelle.
No one laughs at a master quack fool.
Real nice. Many have died from starvation due to the difficulty of finding enough food such as seals.
Shut up! No more Mr. Nice Duck. That's it. Right, Mr. Zitz?
What do you make of that?
You know, it's the most fantastic story I've ever heard.
The Round Carpet Podcast.
I like what you've done with the set design, mate. It's really nice.
Are you in the ghetto? What's going on, bro?
Yeah, mate. You know how I do. Just roll with the bad boys. Is that how you're opening the show?
Well, do you not want me to do that? Oh, you. Oh, I've got to do that. Okay. Sorry. All right.
Bit of bloody energy, mate. Come on, have a fucking Red Bull or something.
Fire up.
Get there. Come on. Yeah.
Unique New York. Oh, fuck. I just powered off.
The arsonist had oddly shaped feet.
Josh, where'd you go? Welcome to episode 40 of... Hang on. Welcome to episode... Welcome to episode 40...
You can do it.
Fucking talk right over me, you son of a gun.